So in 1978, I was very active, and I am happy that I could be part of all those citizens groups. What you had here too. So a sort of beside the political parties which we have in Germany, and I think they are all beside the neo-Nazis, they are all more democratic than the political parties here in the United States. And we have a wonderful democratic constitution in Germany from 1949 after the war. You should read it, because so often the constitution of the United States is praised, and some of you are claiming that Bush has neglected it. But look into the democratic constitution of Germany. You will find some very good things you would like to have in your constitution too. I'm saying it because I'm standing on the shoulders of those women and men who have done that very good democratic constitution for Germany. It is including equality between women and men as a in the constitution. You don't have that. It's including the dignity of each human being in it, that is relating the United Nations Human Rights Charter. And it is including, now we enriched it. Some things have impoverished, but some is increased, so that we even with the Greens in Parliament got an article into the Constitution for the responsibility for the next generations, for the environment. How could the Greens do that? So I have to try to begin with the starting. In 1978, we had that wonderful anti-nuclear movement in Germany, concentrating in one area with citizens groups, a coalition of citizens groups against the nuclear reprocessing plant, which is parallel to the nuclear reprocessing plant in La Hague, which is a horrible waste plant and going into the waters of the Atlantic. And many workers there are suffering cancer. People living near these are suffering, the children are suffering leukemia. You know, there's a lot of danger from the nuclear, just not coming from an accident like in Chernobyl, which is horrible. I have been there, killing more thousands of workers who try to clean up, really killing them by radiation, and wounding thousands, hundreds of thousands of children and young people who suffer different forms of cancer since then. But beside that is the lower radiation problem. So we have been fighting this nuclear reprocessing plant in Gorleben by that reason too, that even we have to think and to know more and to educate people about lower radiation. To get an international coalition against nuclear energy, nuclear power plants, and nuclear weapons, I went to Ireland, because there was a first conference in a coalition of trade unions and housewives associations. And I found that very interesting. I found that very creative. I found that, oh, that is an interesting coalition. I cannot imagine to have that in Germany. I have to go there and learn. And I went there, and I came to know the leader of the trade unions, which was John Collins. And he had a friend at that time that was Petra Kelly. So I came to know Petra Kelly and Helen Caldicott, Alice Tears, Anna Sternglass, Peter Bench, you do not know, a wonderful independent expert on energy politics from Austria. So it was a wonderful meeting of some people from whom I could learn a lot, and they inspired me a lot. And it was, in a way, the historic meeting or the spiritual meeting between Petra Kelly and me, because since that moment we have been personal friends and political friends for the next 14 years. And so I learned at that conference to maybe organize women in another way, not just as academic feminists, but to relate much more out and have much more outreach on real life issues like health and good food and good education with women living in the countryside and non-academic women and farmers' women, and that they can go into a coalition on important issues like energy and water with trade unions. Trade unions have to learn a lot from the consumer side, and trade unions too have to learn a lot from the housewives and vice versa, because these worlds, the daily life and the company and the factory, are mostly in this in our industrialized countries very much separated. So by that experience and life experience and how to change both is separated too. To bring it together was wonderful. And then Petra Kelly called me after that conference, where she had come to know me, and it seems that she liked my commitments. And she said, "Eva, visit me in Brussels. I'm sitting here in my office in Brussels at the European Union Fine. I never had been to Brussels, and seeing these big lobby buildings and slowly understanding that politics in Europe is not more done anymore in the national capitals, but part of it and the lobbying of the industrials and the corporations lobbies is starting to be an important place is Brussels. So that was a big learning I got from Petra Kelly there, that I have to take the decision making in Brussels at the European Union more serious and not just do local struggles and not just relate to the national parliament. And then in March 1979, I just had had an accident, I think, that was linked, that they'd started to drill at the nuclear waste testing site, which I was very much linked with. So I got her phone call when I was more or less in hospital, and it was a historic phone call because she said, "Hello, Eva, how are you? You have to come and run with me for European Parliament, and you have to be second. I want to be first, you have to be second." And in a way, I took the telephone a little bit like that, and I started to laugh, but I did not want to offend her by her nice proposal, because at that time I was not at all interested in party politics. I thought political parties are too bureaucratic, they get to have too much self-interest, they are not looking into the important issues which coming out of the citizens groups, they need so much time to learn new issues and new agendas, and then sometimes the best people are thrown out and mopped away. So I thought, I have learned now new organizing social movements, that's the future now, and maybe the only thing I will do is interlinking the different social movements more. What I did, that I always combined then the women's movement, the environmental movement, and the peace movement. You cannot divide me in these issues anymore. And I try always to combine these three issues. So from Petra Kelly then, I learned that we can take another step of policy making out of our demands to stop nuclear weapons, to support ecological farming, to support clean and good food companies, and to support women and human rights, and to support a change in development politics. That means that not dumping our waste and our products in Africa, but to help them to develop themselves, but into another way of development. That was what the anti-nuclear energy movement and the ecology movement, together with parts of the women's movement, learned was, if we really want to criticize wrong energy politics, we have to rethink economic growth and we have to rethink economic development, and to go out not just for ourselves, for our own countries, but we should not sell wrong development models then to Latin America, Africa and Asia neither. You see that they all have to have car cities, they all have to have air conditioning, they all have to have nuclear power plants, and the so-called big elephant development projects and dams and so on, which is only creating debt for their countries, and which is partly the policy that has been the policy of the World Bank and the IMF. The World Bank learned a little bit by the power of the people and the power of critical movements the last years at least, but they have done rather bad so-called development politics by cutting the public sector, cutting the health and education sector, and by increasing debt and going into monetary politics and to go into export politics where the local farmers are losing and there is more degradation of soil and water and forest, and that they are forced to sell their rainforest, that they are ugly and horrible working conditions in the mines, that there is this running after resources of oil in Nigeria, about coltan in Congo and so on. And so the Greens did not just start in 1979 by a simple agenda like, oh, we want to go out of nuclear energy here in Germany and just have a little bit more citizens involved in politics. No, we had a really world concept, I would say, a planetary global concept at that moment, even in 79, and we were not the first to think it. I think a lot of that thinking, global thinking, has been mature even in California at that time, and in some Japanese women's food corporations too. That has been, there is something like a growing of something like a planetary consciousness, that how we have to change our lifestyles, how we have to restructure our economies, and what I always want to add, we have to restructure science too. So that it is not in the end destroying, and that it is serving communities, and not just rich communities, but that it is not, that science is not destroying the earth and good old heritage, and maybe other forms of knowledge, like indigenous people's knowledge or old women's grandmother's knowledge, not to, but to come to another form of economy, science and technology and lifestyle and forms of organizing and living, structuring communities and cities and the link between the rural and the cities. So we had something like a holistic agenda then. And the founding process of the Greens is very interesting, I think, for you too, because to become a political party, we had to put a program together. And you know, from the Germans or the older Germans, they like then to have a lot of paper, a lot of writing, a lot of debates. So maybe that was a little bit, a lot of time consuming, mountains of papers. But it was a good training too, because we had to learn how we bridge the different issues. That those who were coming and saying there are problems with the electromagnetic fields, those who were saying more women's rights, those who were saying more rights for gay people, those who were saying local farmers should not be fully put down, not eliminated by big agribusiness, those who were saying we need more bikes in the city, those who were saying, we have to have another development policy for Africa, they came together. These different type of groups came together to write a common green program. And it was not easy. There were a lot of struggles and conflicts in between. But some of us, I think, learned then to combine these issues in a common thinking, and then to have some priorities in what are long-term goals of us, middle-term goals of us, and immediate goals of us. So that was an educating and disciplining process where we had to learn to talk to different groups. Otherwise, we would not have a common program, and otherwise, we would never have entered by 5% the national parliament. And that is a, what is it? Is a, you see, you can make nice programs with some left radical groups, one feminist group, one anti-new group, and maybe, like in Italy, they get by the voters 0.3%. Fine, it's nice, they are in Italy. But what was one decision of those who have written our constitution, and the women was, so we had mothers and fathers of the democratic constitution, they thought one mistake of the Weimar Republic before fascism could rise was that there were too many political parties. You see, we had not the problem that you only have two political parties, who sometimes are rather similar here in the US, and a lot of big money is going in, but we had too many. That means it was a too much split, and that then maybe the Social Democrats could not win and the trade unions could not win in the elections because too many, either right-wing, too many left-wing, taking the balance. So they said they should, each party can only enter national parliament if they get 5%. And that, so in the first elections of the Greens in 1979, which has been the first direct election to the European Parliament, they are then decided and got motivated by Petra to run with her in a way as a team. We got 3%. That was from 0 to 3. That meant 5 million voters from zero. That was a lot. And it gave us not only the courage to go on, and after that, newspapers started to take us serious. They did not write any article about us in the election campaign. They, even a journal like Spiegel, preferred to write about a little, very stupid election group, because in a way, they could not imagine that something serious could come out of this ecology, this mixture of feminists, ecologists, human rights fighters, and some development groups. They did not take us serious. And the traditional left and left intellectuals were even campaigning against us and saying, they are for nature, but the Nazis have been for nature too. You see, they did not, a part of the left and the liberals did not understand, and the trade union, part of the trade unions did not understand why we put ecology on the first agenda, and that ecology is a social issue too, that to ecology and to save the soils, to save the forest, to save the water, has a lot to do with economic and social justice in the end, if you look at it from a broader and world perspective. So they did not take us serious, they ridiculized us, they said we would be too bourgeois, we would have a nature romantic vision. Ah, then they even said, ah, how do you want to live in a modern industrialized society? Do you want to go back to the forests without electricity? You see, it was some really heavy weeks and early years. And then when we had 3%, some left groups came in because there are certain traditions in the German left, they like power. They want to change society by getting power themselves and then get on the, that is this traditional left like Leninism, then take the state and then organize society. And so the Greens, especially with a figure like Petra Kelly, but Josef Beuys was in it too, and Rudi Dutschke and some women from these citizens groups, in a way we had another attitude than the traditional liberals and lefts. We said we have to learn not just to have a goal and then organize for it, but a little bit in the Ghanaian philosophy, we have to walk a little bit our talk. At least, maybe we cannot do it perfect and not purist and 100% because we are going into election politics. That's very difficult to stay 100% pure in that because you need coalitions, you need compromises to get one step at least and not just only talk in parliament, but get something, change the budget. To change the budget, you need coalitions. So we knew we cannot achieve our goals immediately, but at least we did not want to say the way we are taking, during the way we have to take and have to take steps and phases, we want to have a form of political organization and a form of lifestyle which is not fully against what we want to achieve as goal. That means we wanted to have more, we wanted to have women's equality within the organization from the beginning. So I and Petra Kelly introduced the quota system for women within the Green Party. So from the beginning, we have 50% women and 50% men in all, especially high-level jobs of the Greens. So there were different elements to change the structures and the organizing of political parties, including left and liberal parties. It was not just the quota for women, it was speaking time. That means we have a rule for speaking time at each assembly. Maybe we learned it from the indigenous people, but and from the sitting in a circle in our nonviolent blockades and actions to learn grassroots democracy. That we look for the speaking time, not just, you see, that the jobs are equal to women and men, and now we are including migrants and other minorities too, that they should be there in a certain proportion. But the speaking time, I think that is very interesting, that element, that not somebody is making a speech of 20 minutes and a woman is coming having only 1 minute, but that we try to balance it. The other thing, very important related to US politics, is that we are running anyway elections without any sponsors and lobbyists giving us money. But we get, if we have been successful in elections, we get taxpayers' money from the state. And then with that money, what we got by the 3% for the Greens in the beginning, we had at least 2 million or 3 million German mark by that. With that taxpayers' money, then we can build our organization and our education system and be independent from big sponsors. That is very important. But beside that, we said we do not want politicians to earn too much money. We want to have transparency, what Obama is saying now, transparency and accountability of the politicians. They should not be too long in their jobs. So we decided even in the beginning, it was a beginning, that only half a term any politicians should be in office. That means they would earn half of what the others are earning. They would have to learn to open the doors and make a learning team for the next, so not keep the knowledge for themselves and then run again, but to include others following them. So the first years, we had only 2 years and a half term within one legislature, and then the next came in. So that meant more people had the possibility to get involved in election politics, more people had the possibility to have experience in it and work with that knowledge, either staying in it or going to another profession or going back to the NGOs and grassroots. It is now not anymore 2.5 years, but it is now a rule that it should be only one legislature or two. So the Green became more pragmatic latest when they have been in government than 20 years later in 98. But in the beginning, I think it was rather a cultural political revolution to change a party system. And so we have the money, so accountability of the money which is going to the politicians, no sponsoring from any big company. Now we sometimes have party assemblies where at least we invite the solar industry or local farmers to be there and show that they can use the party assembly in a little bit to show what they are doing and get interest. But I think that's totally different to the tobacco industry, the car industry, or the nuclear industry, or then I don't know, big media sponsoring an election campaign like here in the U.S. It's anyway just the contrary. And then we had this rotation system that more follow one another, and so bigger capacities to learn. And and on the websites now, at that time we had no websites, but now you can look on the website of the Member of Parliament, and they have to announce if beside Parliament they have any other little job. You see, especially lawyers are in temptation to earn beside, because lawyers, you see. So they are forced by the Greens made their own laws for themselves in a way, that they are forced to announce anything. If they earn $500 or only $100 extra, they have to announce it on their website. And we introduced a law that all political parties in Germany should have to do it. So by giving a good example ourselves, that was very important. I think that we got so much votes in the beginning then from grassroots and people who were fed up and disappointed with traditional form of politics. But it was giving too an example to the others. It was in a way building up a certain moral pressure, democratic pressure on other parties. And one of our first campaigns was going into a corruption scandal of the Christian Democratic Party, which had received money from the arms industry. You see, there are some dirty arms sales going to Iraq, Iran, from the US, but from European countries like from Germany and France too. So we used our presence in the National Parliament since 1983 to make hearings on issues where we thought maybe the mainstream media are not informing enough about, and it's not enough that just an alternative journal or nowadays an alternative website is informing about. With our Green Politics from the beginning, we try to strengthen public democratic debates and dialogue, because it's not the point only that you get some other politicians in office, like the Greens, and that they are not corrupt, and to have rules not to get them corrupt, and to have rules to give women the same share in it, but that you always have to serve as a politician, or you should serve as a Green politician, that the public democratic space is lively and open enough. That means you have to create and look for your resonance, and that grassroots groups, good professional groups, can feed into the debate of the political party, and that you organize in a way your own democratic control. Maybe some of the Greens lost a little bit of that within the last 30 years, but for me it is very important, coming from that history of Germany fighting to prevent that democracy is not eroding and destroyed by ugly regimes, and to fight for lively democracy. I find it essential that the Greens do not give up a responsibility, not just to do good green politics, but to be responsible with others, with trade unions, with independent media, with churches, to keep a lively democratic space where really open debate can happen, not just in the internet, but where people meet, where they learn the dialogue, where they learn political conflict, where they learn to find solutions and democratic solutions together. So you can use a public hearing, which you sometimes have at Congress too. I learned it here that you had a good hearing here at Congress about nuclear testing. So there are good hearings here at the Congress in Washington. But it would be very interesting for you to look into the hearings which the Greens did at the National Parliament in Germany. But then, when we entered European Parliament in 84, 83 National Parliament in Germany, 84 European Parliament, we could do public hearings in the European Parliament too. And that is very good, and that has been increasing our capacities to interlink movements and alternative politics, because by this we can translate everything what we are doing there into different languages. And you can go on the website of the European Parliament, because what you cannot read from the documents of the National Parliament and the German Greens, you can read there in English, in Spanish, in Italian, and in the different European languages. So that, in that sense, the Greens are still, though they have done compromises and are not so radical anymore like in the beginning, but at least with their existence in the European Parliament, they serve other movements, just because they have much better access in their language now, in Polish language, even in Hungarian language. They can immediately get the documents of the Greens against biotechnology, against Monsanto, and against the nuclear industry, and for alternatives in the renewable field, and in to build something like a social security system for Europe, or to build a new eco tax. I introduced, when I was elected the second time, but then could enter the European Parliament because then we got 8% of the votes. I introduced as one of my first actions eco tax, the eco tax idea into the European Parliament. And I did it from the Environmental Commission, which is a consumer environment and health commission, to these issues together. And that was a strategic point, that then the other political parties had to start a debate how to change tax politics so that we have better food politics, so that we have better development politics, better energy politics. And it was a big struggle, and I was happy that I had a colleague from Portugal. He was from a liberal party, which in that sense means a little bit neoliberal, but he was a committed former environmental minister, and he took the idea. So we had a debate about ecological taxes in the European Parliament even in 92. And you need that now too, because some people here start to debate about changing the tax system and introducing ecological taxes on CO2 emissions, on cars, on other types of emissions. And I think that would be something I would be very happy that you here use some of our progress and relink it what you have been doing here and which did not enter our mainstream media. So there is, then Petra called me the first time in 78, and I was thinking, oh no, party politics, no. I have better things to do. Now I would say, I'm older and have more experience, and I would recommend, especially the US citizens, to do your grassroots work, organize in alternative communities, organize good trade unions, but do not leave electoral politics to the right wing and to the egoists and to the plutocrats, but try to find possibilities how at least in municipalities you can get alternative and independent people into electoral politics at the same time, and not see it as either or, but try, because the other lobbies we are standing against, the dirty industrial lobbies, the financial speculators and so on, they are using all the different levels at the same time. They use the mass media, they use even that they get their ear, even they get even their ear into NGOs, they use the parliament, they are lobbying in Washington. So I think when I saw what the nuclear industry is doing, on which different levels they are doing lobbying, I thought, sorry, we have to be intelligent too, and so look that we get our lobby structures independent, alternative, not corrupt, really serving the need of poor people and decent people. And we have to build up our different lobby structures alternative science, alternative media, grassroots, but not leave electoral politics and not leave mass media and science politics only to the other big lobbies. And just by saying, oh, we want to be clean, we want to be pure, or to be cynical and say, oh, you never can change election politics in the US. So in a way, I think many Europeans would like to support that there is no fraud in elections again in the US, and that there is not too big business, which is a condition to run for office, and that you get a more independent ecological space within the Democratic Party, who are really doing good democratic politics, and maybe a good third political party in the US would be possible, at least on municipal level. And I think that is no wrong interference from outside, like McCarthy would, they are influences from outside. No, you see, when they are all the time saying globalization is good and we are doing globalization, sorry, we are doing our own globalization, but in a very different way. And we have to interfere if there's human rights, human rights, heavy human rights violation, and if there's heavy democracy violations in another country, not because we want to interfere from outer forces, but we live in a planet together more and more, we are interdependent more and more, and I want to have the democratic right to help other people that they do not suffer fraud and corruption and stupid arms race and stupid dirty industry contamination. So I think we have a right to stand together as global and planetary citizens and organize together, be local, regional, national, international and global at the same time. So it's not anymore let's either be global or local, but we have, as Peter Kelly and the Greens said in the beginning, what do we say? Think globally, act locally. That was our first election slogan. Think globally, act locally. And what I then said 10 years later, when the wall was coming down and Women for Peace, I'm a co-founder of, has been helping a lot because we have been organizing in East and West from and made our coalitions from below and from beyond the wall for many years. Then I had the feeling since 1989, which means not just a simple end of the Cold War, because a lot of the waste of the Cold War is still there. A lot of the lobbies who made profits by the Cold War are still there. So it's no simple end. It's a big joy on the wall of Berlin, dancing there, but a lot of work is to be done to clean the waste and the heritage of the Cold War, which is sinking into the sea in Russia with the nuclear submarines and ugly chemical industries. But there is too some mental waste of it. And that means how can we really go into peace dividend? How can we really go into good global transborder cooperation? And some guys who are using 1989 immediately has been the mafia. So when I saw the mafia entering rather obvious, some mafia men rather obvious, not very hidden, Berlin, I could see it because another type of man was coming in trying to control the streets near prostitution restaurants and so on. I thought, what is this? We did not have that in West Berlin before, and we had a very strong women's movement in a way, changing the way you can walk in streets. That means that as a woman you can walk like that in a street, you see, and not like this. And that is starting to change with different types of little mafia and gangs coming into the city. So I thought maybe when the mafia is organizing globally, the arms industry, arms trade, small arms especially, which is horrible for Africa and other regions, they are moving without borders globally. The drug industry moving without borders, the trafficking women and children, it's horrible, and partly they are even interlinked in that horrible, dirty business. Then maybe it is not enough to think globally and to act locally. Maybe then we have to think and act local and to think and act global in the environmental movement, in the women's movement, in the ecological agriculture and good health movement. So I hope we do it.